Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. So happy to be back with you on a Monday. It always feels so good to be back on a Monday. Thank you for making that possible. Thanks for being with us. Our number is 888-318-7884. And boy, do we have a good Monday for you. Second hour, our good friend, Father Sebastian Walshe, will be here to talk about his new book, Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith for Life and Bring Them Back If They Have Strayed. This hour, a guest, I wish I could talk to Liz Lev just about every week, but I'm just delighted to have her back. Art historian Elizabeth Lev is our guest, and your sacred art questions are welcome. We're really not going to limit you. If you've got a sacred art question, you're welcome to call. Liz Lev is the author of How Catholic Art Saved the Faith, The Triumph of Beauty and Truth in Counter-Reformation Art. She teaches Baroque, Renaissance, and Christian art at Duquesne University in Rome, and she has a wonderful, wonderful tour company. If you're thinking about doing some art touring in Rome, she's the person to check in with. Elizabeth Lev, thank you very much for being here with us.
Well, thank you for such a great introduction, and I'm hoping people will be able to tour in Rome soon.
Maybe start there. Give us an update. What do you think? When will we be able to do it?
This is just my opinion. So I don't have a crystal ball, and I certainly don't have an in with the Italian government, but it feels a little bit like the last gasp of the lockdowns. Many of your listeners probably know that we've had this last kind of what they call the red lockdown, where restaurants are closed and we've kind of gone back to almost what it was like a year ago. But we know in Rome it's a lot less stringent. We don't have the same police presence and the same scare-to-cat tactics, and it feels a lot, I think, to us in Rome, like this is the last gasp of the restrictive environment.
Okay. That's good, because I saw on the internet, I don't know, maybe you're not allowed to talk about this, with you giving a tour of Rome to American TV star Kevin James. I was like, wow, she's a big deal. Do you remember this?
Oh, that was great fun.
Yeah.
That was really great fun, and what a just lovely Catholic family. It was one of those very therapeutic tours with a Hollywood person where you talked about God and you talked
about
beautiful. Jesus and you talked about faith. I mean,
that's great.
Ooh, that felt good.
but all kinds of folks you've given tours of, and is it always. Is there always a faith element for people, or is that sometimes lacking? The people don't get that Rome is a Christian city, in addition to everything else it is, that it's a Christian city and that there is an element of faith to all of this.
So difficult for people to imagine, but I've actually had tour requests where I don't really want to hear anything about faith. I'd like to see the Vatican and the Sistine Chapel from the psychological point of view or the technical point of view, but I really don't want to hear anything about the faith point of view. You can probably imagine how well that works out with me. But I find that even though people tend to put, I have a lot of people who kind of the big barrier at the beginning is, we're not Catholic, we don't know anything about the Catholic Church, and that kind of tone, like we don't want to know anything about the Catholic Church. But I find that understanding a little bit about the faith for anybody makes the works more clear, makes the works speak more. It's like the works are speaking a language. And if you don't want to understand at least hello, please, and goodbye, then there's really no point in you thinking you're going to communicate in that country. And so people seem to be, I have found universally, people are very amenable to at least learning, if you will, the hello, please, thank you, goodbye of Christian iconography. And that gives me a lot of hope with people and a hope in the world in general.
Our number 888-318-7884. If you have questions for our guest Liz Lev, I'll just mention the book "How Catholic Art Saved the Faith: The Triumph of Beauty and Truth in Counter-Reformation Art," among other things that our guest has written. I want to ask you today, kind of about it's funny because we've been getting questions about like Renaissance art, and they come along the lines of this: How is it that there was this great outburst of this beautiful Catholic art, and we don't see that anymore? So I'll just start right there. However articulate or inarticulate that question is, how do you explain that moment and why we're not living in that moment anymore?
Ever since I saw that, I don't know how long ago this interview we set up was, but I remember the second I saw it, I was like, yes, my favorite question.
Okay.
Because it's a really really important thing to ask ourselves. So what is it, besides the genius of the artist, what is it that makes all that art available? I mean, those of you who have been to Rome, who have been to Florence, who have been to Venice, who have been to Paris, where do you go and see these works? They're in churches. They're works that were made for people's houses and end up in museums. Part of the problem is the lack of patronage, right? So this is an era, the is an era where when people want to express, look how successful I've been, look how great, how God, I've risen above my circumstances, how do they do it? They do it by commissioning a great work of art in a chapel. It's not, it was a way for people to, in one way, express their piety. So if we were speaking today, in today's speak, we might call it, oh, all that virtue signaling in building those chapels.
Right.
But the fact is, it was a way for people to express their success, their status, their gratitude. And it's very important to remember for their gratitude, their sense of community, and their sense of giving back. Commissioning a beautiful work of art for a public place like a church is a way of giving back. So these people can have 15 works of art in their house, but they give one or two or five or 20 inside a church where other people can see them. And that made the entire world more, the world that they lived in, so the world of Renaissance Italy, people were more aware of the saints' days, the saints' stories. It was more than just, oh, wait, it's the 19th and it's St. Joseph and I can eat meat on Lent and on Friday in Lent. It wasn't just, oh, it's St. Patrick's. But people knew all of those saints, Barbara, Lucy. They were part of your world. They were part of who you commemorated. And so you had a much more literate audience for art.
So we don't have a culture of patronage then is at least part
Absolutely
of the problem.
Not. Absolutely not. We do not have a culture of artistic patronage. And it's something that the more the years pass, the more I realize if we would like to create a new Renaissance, we need to create new Renaissance patrons. People who are aware of what of art and what they're looking for and what, you know, a sense of an aesthetic, people, but even people who are willing to put a work of art in their houses that is Christian. So instead of having like the sort of pretty little sunset painting or something that just sort of is neutral and makes us feel good, I mean, if you put up a work of art, if you put something interesting that has a story behind it, when you bring people over, that thing you want people to pay attention to, and then you tell the story. Oh, we picked that up when we were in Singapore, and ha ha ha, it's a funny story. Well, if you do that with sacred art, oh, well, I saw this painting and I was thinking about how much I really admire St. Monica and how much it's important to me as a mother. I mean,
yeah,
there are ways that we can incorporate art into our lives, into our daily lives, and it's a very easy way to evangelize.
Again, our number is 888-318-7884. We're talking about sacred art with art historian Liz Lev. 888-318-7884. I imagine that there was, I mean, how did you, in the olden days, how did you find, you know what, I'm going to get a Da Vinci painted, and then how would I do it today? Like, I wouldn't know how do I find someone who really can make beautiful art and patronize that person so that they have a living, for one thing, and they can keep producing art, but also so that more beautiful objects come into the world.
So this is going to be a little bit, see if I can be clear. So the Renaissance, one of the great events that happens in the Renaissance is name recognition, or if you will, branding for artists.
Okay.
Artists become known by name. So suddenly Leonardo da Vinci becomes Leonardo da Vinci. He's standing on the shoulders of 100 years of artists who have worked very, very, very hard for name recognition. What is very interesting about the name recognition question is that the major players in getting artists' names known were the religious orders. It is the Franciscans who are commissioning, the Giottos who are commissioning, the Pietro Cavallinis, the Ambrogio Lorenzettis, and that's how these names, actually very specifically, the Franciscans and the Dominicans begin to identify who has the potential to produce the to see. And then they further those artists. And the next thing you know, these artists start to, they form them, they help them. And next thing you know, we have names that go up in lights. Once you have a generation of people who have raised up from, I think the famous story is that Giotto, who is He's a name in the history of art that for art historians, it makes us catch our breath. He's so important. And he started out, the story is, as a goat herd. So this is the reason why this story exists. Whether or not it's true, can't tell you. But I will tell you there's a reason why that story exists. This kid was out sketching and watching goats. So that would be the lowest social strata you can possibly imagine.
Right.
By the end of his life, he's working for kings and popes. And the point of the story, he's hanging out with Dante Alighieri. The point of this story is that if you have artistic talent and it is recognized, you can be raised from nothing to everything, kind of like the way we treat professional sports, right? Right now, that you can you can come from nothing and you can become a professional sports star and become, you know, a globally known face, or you can be, you know, a movie star. That's our path, for our fast path for glory. But in that world, it was the ability to communicate through the arts, and that growth creates. Yeah. I want Leonardo da Vinci. And it's a novelty. It's so new when it happens.
Do you have hope that we could have that come back again, at least within our community, or no?
I do.
You do?
I do, because I've been worried about this for years, and because of it, it's a conversation that comes up. And I began to realize a lot of people out there who are busily trying to further Catholic artists, who are trying to help them get noticed, who are trying to kind of bring them together so you can see, look, these are all these different people working in the arts. On one hand, there is a real attempt to value, lift up, encourage, and try to create competitions.
Yeah.
So that these artists can compete against each other, see what they're doing, see, you know, this is the Renaissance we all recognize in the history of art. The Renaissance began with a competition. It was Donatello versus Ghiberti, and it was for the doors of the baptistry of Florence. And it was that competition that began a Renaissance, which is really about competition. Leonardo is competing with Michelangelo. Michelangelo is competing with Raphael. I mean, there was, again, like professional sports, there was always the young, hungry person who was right behind you. So you really had to always bring your A game. And so I feel like there's a lot of attempt to bring that out in the artists. Now we need, from the other part, we need to start looking at people who realize, you know what, I would like to have a holy family in my house. My favorite saint is Catherine of Alexandria. I would like a painting of Catherine Alexandria, which is not, you know, a retread. I don't want a Caravaggio painting. I want Catherine of Alexandria the way she would look to me today in 2021. And that's, I think, what would bring about sort of the fullness of a Renaissance.
Liz Lev is our guest. Our number 888-318-7884. If you want to talk about the Renaissance, I'd love it if you would. But if you have a general, we're not going to say no to a good art question, sacred art question, 888-318-7884. The spring sale continues here. You can get everything over at shop.catholic.com. 10 to 25% off. Is it spring yet? I mean, the spring sale continues, but is today the first day of spring? All right, we started early. We're just really early with our sale. Go to shop.catholic.com right now and start savings.
Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
EWTN is now on Twitter. Get short, timely messages from EWTN on your computer or cell phone. It's easy to stay up to date on a wide variety of topics. Pro-life news, Vatican announcements, catechesis, apologetics, the latest EWTN programming, and more. You can link to EWTN on Twitter from our homepage or go to twitter.com/EWTN. At work, at home, at school, and on the road, stay connected to your world with EWTN's Twitter page.
Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Delighted to have you with us on this Monday. And we get to talk to one of our favorite people, Liz Lev, who just will fire you up with the beauty, with the magnificence of art, and also with the work art can do. I don't know if I'm allowed to say it that way, but the work of opening up the truth about the world to us, and especially the supernatural truths about the world. 888-318-7884 is our number. 888-31-TRUTH. Not too long ago, I'm out in public and I see a guy and he's walking down the street and he's got a sweatshirt on, and across the front of it is, it's branded with a name, and the name is Jean-Michel Basquiat. And I thought, that's weird. like that's weird. But the thing that you were saying about branding, someone like Basquiat, who's very, maybe you see religion in it. I don't. It seems very secular to me. But there are very prominent artists working today. Are there prominent Christian? I mean, obviously Basquiat's not working today, but.
No, and Basquiat, I mean, he was very, very interesting in his own right, but I wouldn't say he's the direction that you're looking for. Although Andy Warhol, on the other hand, did have a very interesting he had a very interesting religious or Christian slant to him. Now, we do have artists working today. We have quite a few artists working today. Their names are just not terribly well known. We have all kinds of painters who are producing. So we have a man named Donny McManus who's working in sculpture. I was thinking about him a lot over St. Joseph's holiday, because he's done many sculptures of St. Joseph, really trying to think in terms of sort of the young, energetic, a very beautiful vision of who St. Joseph was, and that's kind of a thing that he works on. Natalia Tsarkova is a papal portrait artist who did these magnificent portraits of John Paul II, Benedict XVI. I think she did a portrait of Francis. She's done several saint portraits. She's really, really quite a stunning artist. Janet McKenzie, who does this lovely, lovely painting. She's very interested in saints of color. And she has these beautiful purple mauve tones and this very iconic, it's just like an updated form of icon. I think her work is quite lovely. We can keep going, but the more I really appreciate that there are a lot of very interesting ideas out there and ways of envisioning things. So yes.
Okay, I'll get myself a Janet McKenzie sweatshirt, and next time I see the guy with the Basquiat sweatshirt, I'll be like, hey, look at us. We love the art world. There's a bunch of folks on the line for you. You okay to go take some calls now?
I am very happy to take calls.
Our guest is Elizabeth Lev, and if you'd like to get her book, and I do highly recommend it, and it sounds like an outrageous claim almost, how Catholic art saved the faith. Doesn't it sound? But it's not outrageous. It really is a thing that happened. How Catholic art saved the faith, the triumph of beauty and truth in the Counter-Reformation. I hope I didn't offend you by saying that.
I think it's magnificent you referred to it that way, because that's how I feel about it.
Yeah, but it's one where you back up. Let's put it that way. That's what I was trying to get at. That you back up the claim.
The editor held my feet to the fire. Sophia Press, they held my feet to the fire on that one.
Eric in Kansas, listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. You are first up today. Go ahead with your question for our guest, Liz Lev.
Hey, great. Thanks. I appreciate the topic, and I think it's a good question. I have recently come to a position, unfortunately, where I'm on my own again in a long time, but I wanted to hang some stuff up in my apartment. I had a bunch of old stuff I had when I was single, not so neat now, but I do want to put up, I think it would make sense, because it's a good thing, is to put up some good Catholic art. And someone with a limited budget, you know, I'm trying to find out what I could do, whether it's support our upcoming guys and gals who are doing Catholic art, or, you know, some reproductions or something like that. I'm wondering, for your guess.
Yeah, where to start then? On a limited budget, you want some Catholic art in the house.
Well, I would go with, I mean, I when you walk into my house, the very first thing you see is a poster I have from the Vatican Museums of the Holy Family by Federico Fiori, who was one of my favorite painters. And since I can't buy a Barocci, because you can't, but I put that as the very sort of first thing in my house. So I put up a post. I mean, I put up a framed poster. I made it look very nice, but it's, to me, it's a reproduction that I, of a painting that I love. And when people talk about it, lots of people come in and they stop and they talk about it. Our priest, we have this wonderful tradition in Italy where priests come to your house over Easter and they bless, they come through the apartment buildings and they you have house blessings and it's just a normal thing. And it happens in every single neighborhood in Italy. And the priest comes in, he's like, oh, Baroche, we have this whole long conversation about how much we love Baroche. He knows me as the house that has the Baroche. So that's a good way. Reproductions are good. Or, you know, why don't you, you know, one of these days, if your church, if your parish is having some kind of art fair, go see if there's anything you like. If there's anything that maybe you could, listen, Caravaggio was doing cheap devotional paintings when he was spotted by Cardinal Del Monte, and Lord knows what a Caravaggio fetches now. So go take a look and see what people are producing within your budget and see if there's something that speaks to you.
Eric, thank you very much. I know I'm not letting go of my Caravaggios. The price is too good. It's too dear. Thanks, Eric, for starting us. There's a lot of folks who want to talk to you about art, which makes me so happy because I'll tell you the truth, Liz. We don't get our biggest calls on Monday. Monday, people listen. They don't call. So this something we've hit a nerve, and I'm really happy about it. To get to talk about sacred art. Let's go to Brian, Texas, listening on Red Sea Radio is Carla. Carla, thank you so much for your call. Go ahead with your question for Liz Lev.
Hi, I don't have a question per se, but I just wanted to, I love to do Catholic art. I started out, I've always been creative, but I started out teaching, I weaseled my way into teaching art at my kids' Catholic school. And I'm talking to the kids about, you know, how God is the greatest artist of all, and he's actually done everything first, you know, from the rainbow all the way up, and my art started to become religious. And so I know this, I mean, it's very whimsical and very unsophisticated, but your other caller, you could search, you know, Catholic art, hashtag Catholic art or something on Instagram. There are a lot of very affordable Catholic artists that are out there that sell their prints. And there's all kinds of cool stuff out there that, I mean, your home, like she was saying, well, your home is your domestic church, you know, and why not have something beautiful on your wall that happens to be something religious? And it can be, you know, it can be portraits or it can be more subjective. And I just, there's such a wealth of stuff out there. That it just
well,
makes
thanks,
me
Carla.
So excited.
Let me get Liz's reaction to that. I'm interested what you think. Liz.
I think it's true. There you can find a lot of prints. As a matter of fact, there are a lot of sites now, and there are galleries that bring together Catholic artists, and there are reproductions that you can get of Catholic artists. So yes, there is really very little excuse to not be, if you're interested in Catholic art, there's no way you can say, well, I can't quite manage it. And also I think the most important thing you said is that your house is a domestic church. And that is exactly right. And we decorate churches, we decorate places where we gather in the faith. And this is a place where we invite people into our homes to get to know us. We get to know our children, they get to know our pets, they get to know our cooking styles, they get to know our decor. But for some reason, we want to hide the most essential part of our identity, which is that we believe in Jesus Christ. And so I think the having something in your house that really, you know, for better or for worse, it talks about who you really are, because at the end of the day, it's who we are before God. I think that's at the end of the day, the most important discussion you're going to have.
Carla, thanks. It struck me too that she said she taught art in a Catholic school. And I see these Catholic schools now, Liz, with advertising their STEM certification or some other certification. But why should we be teaching art to kids in these Catholic schools as well? Why should they be getting an art education?
The art education, I think, is essential, particularly for Catholic schools, because that is the way that we decided back in 250 AD as a Christian community, we decided to transmit our story not only through our personal witness, but also through the things that we, through art and through imagery. And so we learned to communicate. We managed to speak to a Roman Empire that did not want to hear anything we were saying by engaging through art. And so it is a very, very, very important thing that this language, this is a language which is now 1,800 years old, in which we have spoken about that vocation to holiness that is incumbent upon every single one of us as Christians, that vocation is very beautifully expressed through the beauty of art. And so it is a very, very important thing that young people don't look at Catholic art or Christian art as something that doesn't belong to them. It is part of their legacy.
Again, 888-318-7884. Our guest is Liz Lev. We're talking about sacred art. You are welcome to call with your questions. I got to tell you right now, the lines keep filling up. I think we got to take a quick break. But Liz, I also, when we come back, if you would, maybe we'll let people know how they can contact you if they do want you or one of your colleagues to, when they go to Rome, to have you show them this art.
Absolutely.
Okay, we'll do that when we come back. Liz Lev is our guest. We're talking sacred art, and we've struck a nerve because lots and lots of folks on the line. You can give it a try, 888-318-7884.
We'll be right back with more Catholic Answers Live.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
According to divine command, we should give God worship, but how do we know if we're doing it right? Is worship a form of self-help? To make me feel better? A form of social activism or even a commodity? Or is it something that transcends all of those? In Real Religion, How to Avoid False Faith and Worship God in Spirit and Truth, Father Jeff Kirby cuts through the misguided modern notions about God and religion and takes you back to the foundation for true worship, God's revelation about himself. From his first contact with his chosen people to the culmination of his revelation in Jesus Christ, God shows us what religion is supposed to be like and how to make the practice of it a lifelong virtue in our lives. Order your copy of Real Religion by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Great Monday. Just a great Monday program. Second hour, our friends, Father Sebastian Walshe from the Norbertines up the road from us here, talk about his new book, Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith for Life and Bring Them Back if They've Strayed. This hour, art historian just wonderful speaker, Liz Lev here, talk with us about sacred art, talk with us a bit about what happened in the Renaissance. You're welcome to call with your questions, 888-318-7884. I did want you to let us know, Liz, sometime maybe in the summer, maybe in the spring, at some point they have to open Rome back up again. If people would like to, maybe their group would like to do a tour with you. How do they get in touch with you to do that?
I am very easy. It's elizabeth-lev.com, and you'll find that there are tours, and I think my articles go up there and things I write. And if you need a little Rome fix, my fellow guides and I started a little something called Masters Gallery Rome. So it's mastersgalleryrome.com, where we make videos and we have free web lectures where we talk about Rome. So if you need a little fix, every Wednesday at, I think it is 3 p.m. Eastern time, there is a one of us or me or my colleagues talking about something wonderful in Rome.
Wow, how great. And you can just sign up for that on
if you look on mastersgalleryrome.com, you'll see web lectures. And you'll see the lineup for the next couple months, and they're wonderful. We've been doing a series called Keys to Religious Rome, and I will close the series next week on Monday with a talk on the scandal of the cross, and we'll be talking about crucifixion and the Church of the Holy Cross and what the cross was to ancient Rome, because it's hard for us to imagine. Like, we as Catholics walk into a church, and if the cross doesn't have a corpus, we're like, oh wait, this isn't a Catholic church. But for the early Christians, the idea was, oh no, we can't do that. So it's a fun thing to, it's not fun, but it seemed to me a perfect thing to talk about during Holy Week, how it really was a scandal for the Romans.
I guess, again, Elizabeth Lev, lots of folks on the line heading back to the phones. 888-318-7884, our number. Jim in Kansas, you are up next. Jim, thanks for waiting. Go ahead with your question for Liz Lev.
Yes, thank you. Topic of question, I'm an artist myself, but aside from that, an attitude I run across from a lot of people, and I find it particularly strong in a lot of the clergy, is that only old masters, Renaissance-style art and painting and sculpture are appropriate for this sanctuary and nothing else is appropriate. And I'd just love to hear your view on that.
So I can understand where they're coming from. There has been a sort of a great divorce, if you will, between art, the artistic community, and the church. The church has occasionally tried to bridge that divide by allowing for a kind of art that ends up alienating the faithful, either because it's excessively abstract or because it is excessively secular. So there's been a sort of a difficult reattaching on the part of the institutional church to artists. And I think that's why sort of looking to sort of the bishop or the pope to resolve this problem is not the answer. It's not really Pope Francis's job to get, you know, us liking art again. I think it is. So I do understand their point of view. At the same time, I do believe that a lot of modern churches, we are built a lot of churches in a work of art by Barocci, my beautiful Barocci painting, would really look ridiculous in some of these modern churches. Like, what is that doing there? It's like someone just decided to throw some 1600 just for giggles. And that kind of art requires a different kind of, that kind of space requires a different kind of art. So I think there needs to be a sort of a return to a conversation, and I tend to feel that that conversation will happen more successfully in more the capillaries of the church than the sort of the major organs. So you start by getting used to a space, to a parish. You get used to a family that wants to patronize art. Maybe there's a religious order that's kind of looking for their new chapel, and a dialogue has to happen to reconnect. I mean, this has really been a serious falling out. It's like a marriage in which the couple stopped communicating for a very long time, and now they look at each other with suspicion. And so, you know, a little bit of learning how to speak to each other again and understanding you have to give a little on both sides, it's just simply going to have to happen.
Jim, thank you for that question. Really appreciate it. There, it does seem to me, Liz, and I wonder what your take is on this, that some of what has happened in the modern period with art is actually intentionally a critique of, or even a kind of a slap in the face of, some of the older aesthetics. And it seems like some of that cannot be incorporated into sacred art, because that the kind of... The fact that it is itself a critique of sacred art kind of makes that impossible. Am I way off on that?
No, this has been a much longer process, I think, than people realize. I mean, it began in the 19th century when subject matter stopped being religious. So the major patrons, the major places where artists started to gravitate in order to produce works of art were academies, salons, and then later on galleries, right? So just works that are going to be sold. And this is the kind of the progression from when the church was the great patron up until about the 1700s. And then we see this, and the kings were great patrons, and the kings tended to be Catholic. So we see this sort of progression away from that to the academy, from the academy to these salons, from the salons to the marketplace. And it begins to be the market that makes the decision about the art. And the market, the art is sort of sold as a kind of ultimate liberty. And of course, the very first form of liberty, we've been watching this happen for the past century, we've been watching this happen in accelerated fashion in the past 20 years. The first kind of liberty is we would like to be removed from all restraints of these ridiculous religions, the religio. We don't like being tied up by the absurd moralities of these churches. We don't want their rules. We don't want their... So art becomes much more abstract. It's much less narrative. That already begins to divorce art from any kind of, you know, way of evangelizing, because what is the Bible? It's a book of our story. I mean, we are a story. We have a story to tell. We have something to narrate. We have an actual historical event that happened of the incarnation that we need to talk about. So the more that we try to create an abstraction of that with the people who don't really know what the Annunciation is, we've really created an enormous void. So yes, we have a lot of work to do in order to return art. But I'm telling you, the fact that your phones are, you know, lit, the fact that people go to museums when they could, and they want to know, they do want to know. I think people are becoming a little bit more willing, especially a society that has just been bound by rules. I think it's really interesting when art is supposed to not have any rules, right? So we got all of this modern art because suddenly art shook off these rules. There are no restrictions we want, no confinements, no barriers, no anything. But we have just lived a year under restrictions, we've had to learn how to be fruitful and multiply in our lives under restrictions. And we might just be more willing to understand that sometimes having gateposts is something that we need, or something that we have to learn to deal with gateposts in order to be able to play and to grow. I mean, it's a sort of little thought in the corner of my head, but I think we might be ready for a sea change in our thinking.
I don't think I've ever asked a question where I was less sure what I was asking and got a better answer in my whole life. Liz, I'm so grateful for you, because I was kind of fumbling for a question, and my gosh, what a wonderful lesson in where we are in the contemporary art situation. Thank you so much. And Jim, thank you. Thanks for that question. Let's go to Germantown, Maryland. John, listening on WMET Radio, you are next. Go ahead with your question for our guest, Liz Lev.
Hey, Liz, I got two quick questions. One is, can you talk about the letter to artists written by JP2 and how that's changed and affected things? And secondly, if you could talk a little bit about iconography and how that's different. I'll hang up and listen.
So everything I just said last minute was all, I think your question is well suited, because I basically cribbed it from St. John Paul II. St. John Paul II is like, oh yeah, you think you're going to take the credit for my thinking? St. John Paul II really was the one, Paul VI before him in his own way, but St. John Paul II really began to talk about trying to close the divide between artists and artists and the church. It was a very active attempt to create this bridge between the two. And what John Paul II started, really Benedict XVI, then followed up in a very powerful way, helping artists. So it's kind of like the Council of Trent, which proclaims that the church is going to reestablish a relationship with art. In 1563, when the Council of Trent closed, there was a real question about whether or not the church was going to commission art, because there had been a falling out. There had been problems between artists and the church that made the church think maybe we don't want to be commissioning art anymore. And the Council of Trent, like John Paul II, really affirmed an ancient tradition. And John Paul II, being an artist himself with those beautiful poems he wrote about the Sistine Chapel, he has a wonderful sense of what art can do. And he really thrusts art front and center in the church. He gets the Sistine Chapel cleaned. He's commissioning new artists. He added his new chapel in the Vatican. And then Benedict did kind of what happened post-Trent, which was to explain to artists the power they had. And I think when Benedict talks about the power of art to wound, to make us vulnerable, to draw us together, to evangelize, when he speaks that way, the via pulchritudinis, the way of beauty, he really told artists, this is what you need to do in order to bring people back together around a work of art and have art become something that is evangelizing. He didn't say, you have to put halos around their heads and you have to give them their attributes. He just reminded them of what the incredible power that art has. And you know, after a year of sitting at home and watching these, you know, series that Netflix and all these other services keep putting out for us, I mean, think about how much garbage and how many bad ideas people have ingested through the art of television writing, which there are extremely good television writers, but you ingest this bad art. It's in your house. It's in your living room. And what Benedict was trying to do is trying to remind artists that when people ingest this, you need to be giving them something pure, something nourishing, something that will strengthen them. And so I think the two of them, John Paul II and Benedict, were really hugely important in relaunching a dialogue with art. Then the second part of your question, which is iconography, which I don't even know where to begin on this one. I feel like I'm going to occupy the rest of the time on this question. Iconography, which is for your listeners, it is the idea of the study of the image. So what does the image mean? And we can have sort of two ways of speaking about iconography. We can talk about iconography in the more traditional Byzantine, sort of the Orthodox sense of the icon writers, where we see these icons in which every single aspect of the image has a kind of codified meaning. So you look at the work of art, which is, you know, meant to be, it's written, and as it, the word's written, and it's something that as you gaze upon it in prayer, you are sort of picking apart each one of the symbols and using those symbols to enter in prayerfully into the scene. But iconography in Western art, we talk about the ability to recognize the scene that's going on, the attribute of the saint, what's happening in the picture. And frankly, I find teaching young people, and up until 2020, doing tours every single day for people who have a gazillion letters after their names and all the education you want, I've been in the presence of people where when they don't recognize what an annunciation is, or they don't recognize what Jesus is doing, that guy is on the cross, like, oh, there's some guy on a cross. Or I have a story, if any of you guys have a fast access to a computer, my favorite story is I was using an unknown for my students in my exams. I always put up an unknown image, and the student is supposed to start by guessing what the subject is, and after that they're supposed to figure out who the artist is. And I put up an image of a nude female figure, which is the story of Danae. It's by the artist Titian, T-I-T-I-A-N. And it's the mythological story of this woman who was visited by Jupiter in this form of a shower of gold. And I put up, and two of my students said that was the Annunciation.
Oh, with a nude figure.
Nude reclining figure. That's become my school. Two of my students thought it was the Annunciation. At this point, so when we talk about iconography, you are right. I think if I understand the meaning behind the question, the real problem we have now is that we need to bring people back to knowing what your story is. I was in the Detroit Art Institute all day yesterday, and I was listening to people sort of trying to figure out the most basic of scenes or who these saints were. And because people don't know who Barbara or Lucy or Catherine of Alexandria is, you just get this sort of trite judgment of the, well, the Catholic Church doesn't like women or something, instead of really understanding how important these figures are. So yes, iconography is key, which is why I, as much as I appreciate, and I actually kind of like some abstract art, I do not think right now that is appropriate for what the Catholic Church needs. The Catholic Church needs images that things that look like things, so we can reteach people the stories of our salvation that they have simply forgotten.
Liz Lev is our guest. We got to take a quick break. We will be right back.
Sorry.
We'll try to get I just wanted to leave on a high note, and I got nothing. I don't want to say too much because what you're saying is gold, and not from Jupiter either. We'll be right back.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live. Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
This is what St. Teresa of Calcutta, also known as Mother Teresa, once said about prayer. Love to pray. Feel often during the day the need for prayer and take trouble to pray. Prayer enlarges the heart until it is capable of containing God's gift of Himself. Ask and seek, and your heart will grow big enough to receive Him and keep Him as your own. That is why we need prayer.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. I'm going to be a little unfair to Liz Lev at the moment. I'm not going to ask you your answer. I just want to know how many people have asked you about the Vatican Nativity.
Well, it filled my Christmas season.
Yeah, you can read what Liz had to say. You can find it online. I won't force you to go through it again. But she definitely had opinions about it. So 888-318-7884, our number. Art, the great power of art. It's not an accident, is it, Liz, that I was going to talk about the power of art to tell, as you said, tell our story. But the incarnation does something to art. The incarnation of God as a man changes what art can do, doesn't it?
It does. And that is my fundamental problem with art that doesn't look like anything. When God came into the historical world, He didn't come as a blob. He didn't come as a ink spot. He didn't come as an ectoplasm. He came as a human being, and He was touchable, and He was knowable, and He fried up fish for His friends, and people grabbed His robe, and He used His spit in His fingers to cure blindness. I mean, there was indication. I want you to know that I am sharing in this humanity, this physicality of yours. The passion itself is so horrifically physical, what they do to Him. So, I mean, art really, its job is to make present in its own flawed and imperfect way the perfect moment in history when God became man. And it's the whole justification. Otherwise, we have no reason to make art, because the first commandment is very clear, that thou shalt not make images of anything that flies in the air, walks on the earth, or swims in the sea. It's the Old Testament covenant, when God does not hang around with people. When Moses asks to see God, and God can see my face and live. That is, the Psalms cry out, when, O Lord, will I see your face? And then finally we see His face. And we have this incredible privilege, this incredible mystery, this joy. And how do we responding by saying, yeah, I've seen Jesus' face. It looks like an ink blot to me.
I mean, right. Yeah, that's not an adequate response.
The incarnation is the key to the whole business, the key to all of Catholic art. As I tell people who come with me to the Sistine Chapel, the subtext of every piece of great Catholic art you have ever seen, it is one. God became man. He was visible and knowable. That is the subtext. Everything else is gravy.
Jackie in Ohio, listening on 1060 AM, you are next. Go ahead with your question for Liz Leff.
Hello, Liz. This is Jackie Haydu, Father Mark's mom.
Hi, how are you? Hi. Say hi to Father Mark.
I will. I met up with you and Tom at Mark's farewell reception when he was leaving Rome and got reassigned to the States.
Yes, that was
Jackie, I just got to know, Jackie, is that it? You just wanted to do this, or did you have an art question? Because the rest of us are
it's just that the rest of us are
doing a radio show. You do whatever you want, though, Jackie. You do whatever you want.
I thought I better have a question or I wouldn't get it on the radio.
Well, go ahead and give it to us, Jackie.
Okay. Walking through Rome, which I've been several times, you see all these depictions of different things in sacred art, saints and you know, different truths of our faith depicted on the outside of the buildings. Did people hire people or artists to do those, or did they do it to get attention for their skill? How did those come to be on the outsides of the buildings and homes there?
Yeah. There's a thing called a Madonnelle?
Madonnelle. We have hundreds of these. They're called Madonnelle in the cities of Italy. Madonna, and elle is a diminutive. So the Madonnelle are these little images. They can be sculpted, cast, painted. They're made in very different forms, and they usually sit at the corner of buildings, and they have underneath a little votive light that people used to keep lit, and had a very wonderful purpose, these Madonnelle. And they served two purposes. The purpose number one was, because of the lights that are kept lit underneath them, it was a way to illuminate the city at night. And Rome was a very dangerous city. Rome's not a dangerous city now, but it was once a very dangerous city at night. We have all kinds of stories from the time of Caravaggio, of the danger of walking around the streets of Rome at night. And so these Madonnelle provided, on one hand, a kind of a light source for people who were walking in the dark. So, you know, that kind of works out nicely as a metaphor now, doesn't it? And during the day, you pass by these Madonnas and it was an invitation to pray to Mary. So as you go through your day, as you pass these Madonnelle, why don't you say hello to Mary? Why don't you say a Hail Mary as you pass by? And it kept sort of in the capillaries, in the very sort of life of the city, this presence of particularly the Virgin watching over the city. They were made by artists. They were commissioned to make them. They were made by artists who are usually find Caravaggio making a Madonnelle or a Raphael, but that's because the works would be placed outside where they're subject to a great deal of wear and tear. So that's why you don't have like the super artist doing the exterior Madonnelle, but some of them are really extraordinarily beautiful and some of them are miraculous.
Oh, we had a little, sorry, Liz, we had a little audio problem. You said some of them were miraculous, but what followed that?
Some of them were miraculous. Yes, some of them wept. Some of them bled.
Oh.
So yes, some of them have little plaques on them to talk about the miraculous events that are connected to them.
Thank you, Jackie. Appreciate that question. I'm going to continue just because I want to get as many on as I can, and I want to get to Maria in Louisiana. She's been waiting a long time, and Maria, thank you for waiting. Listening on the Almighty 690 AM in Louisiana, Maria, go ahead with your question for Liz Leff.
Oh, thank you. I wanted to see, Liz, if you could speak a little bit about the patrons of the arts of the Vatican Museum and perhaps how, if you would recommend that to someone who's interested in supporting the arts, because I've got to testify to the sheer delight of going on a tour with Liz Leff in Rome. Uh-huh. And I was able to do that with the patrons. So could you speak about the patrons?
Well, I must say, Jackie Haidu teed that up magnificently because her son, Mark Haidu, Father Mark Haidu, was the head of the patrons when I first got very involved with them. And now we have Father Kevin Lixey, who is the head of the patrons. And the patrons mm-hmm. of the Patrons of the Arts of the Vatican Museums is an organization that sponsors the conservation of the works of art in the Vatican Museums. It is a wonderful organization. It is a group of people that is very diverse and very, very interesting. And they work together or individually in order to, in a certain sense, we would say, adopt a work of art, but also take on major projects that that 500-year-old museum needs. I mean, this museum is completely, it has to support itself entirely. It's not getting government grants. And so this brilliant idea, which was a little over 30 years ago, as the cleaning of the Sistine Chapel was taking place, of having a group of people who would be friends of the museum to allow the museum's autonomy, so you wouldn't have to sell out the licensing rights in order to get the money to work on conservation. And now there's a wonderful project right now for those of you, because people can't get to Rome, and I've been part of this. We have an insider's course for the Vatican Museums, and so the patrons of the Vatican Museums are attending this. You can't get to the Vatican Museums, but we're bringing the Vatican Museums to you. So it's a wonderful event.
Maria, thank you for that opportunity for Liz to tell us about that. Liz Lev, we are quite short of time, but that's because you had so many callers. Thank you for a wonderful hour to start our week off. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
You can find her on the internet. Look for Elizabeth Lev, and you will find her and take those tours. We'll see you right after this with Father Sebastian Walshe. Welcome back on this Monday to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and thank you so much for being with us. It means a great deal that you take this time to be with us, and we love being with you. Our number is 888-318-7884, and I imagine the phones will be quite busy this hour, so you might want to dial if you'd like to talk with our guest, Father Sebastian Walshe. Father Walshe is a Norbertine priest from St. Michael's Abbey here in California, and the author of this brand new book. He previously wrote Secrets from Heaven, Hidden Treasures of Faith in the Parables and Conversations of Jesus, and his latest book, Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith for Life and Bring Them Back If They Have Strayed. The first thing I'd say is get Secrets of Heaven and leave it on their coffee table. But I'm sure we'll have many other ideas. Father Sebastian Walshe, thanks for being with us.
Oh, it's great to be back, Cy. Thank you.
I don't know if you know this, but I believe you might have stumbled on the one book that everybody wants. I mean, this is it's an epidemic, really, of parents saying, what happened? The kids reach late teens or early adulthood, and the question is, what happened? And how do I get them back?
Yeah. Well, it's no secret to me from the standpoint of the fact that as a priest, the number one question I get asked is, how do I keep my kids Catholic, or how do I help them come back if they've left? And often they ask, why did they leave? And one thing I think is really true is that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure,
right,
in this front. It's a lot easier to do the things right on the front end and then have to kind of reverse course and help them come back in the back end, because there's a lot of wounds there and a lot of difficulty for them, you know, to re-embrace their faith. But the truth of the matter is that God often has for each person a certain path they have to take in order to be really fully Catholic. I remember one of my friends, they're a wonderful family, but one of their sons sort of went off the rails there and is not living a good moral life. And I said to them, what he's got from his background and his growing up compared to what he's going to have by following this life, there's going to be no comparison. And eventually he's going to want to come back. And when he comes back, he's a child in your, they have a bunch of kids. He's a child in your family that's most likely to become a saint, in my opinion, even though he's living this completely, you know, right, off the rails life. And I have a lot of confidence in that. So hopefully that sense of God's in charge and he's taking care of your children is something that has to be at the root of every parent's response to this crisis.
888-318-7884. If you have questions today for our guest, Father Sebastian Walshe, about keeping your kids in the faith or bringing them back if they have strayed from the faith, 888-318-7884. I mean, certainly one of the things you talk about, an ounce of prevention being worth a pound of cure. One of the things I take from the text here is that it's not a shocker, but living the faith is yourself is a big part of transferring the faith to your children.
Absolutely. And it can't be just living the faith in comparison to the average Catholic. That just doesn't work anymore. Maybe in 1955, when, you know, everyone was going to church every Sunday and people had a lot of different, you know, Catholic, you know, activities they were doing, and they were watching Fulton Sheen once a week on TV, and you know, in a previous world, almost 100 years ago now,
yeah,
it may be that it was easy to sort of go with the flow. But to be a Catholic today, just to be a serious Catholic, means to be very countercultural and to do things that the world thinks are weird. I'll be honest with you, you know, that the world would just say, no, you shouldn't do that. That's just strange or different. And then on top of it, you have to be joyful, right? Think of how the first Christians looked to the early Romans and try and reproduce that in the modern world. That's really the idea, is, you know, you have to be something that's very obviously in the world but not of the world, and something which is strikingly different, so that everyone sees this striking divide between who's a Catholic and who's not. And without that, really there's very little hope that your children are going to catch fire and embrace the faith, right?
Yeah, right, exactly. There's going to be, I do think there's, no matter, I could do everything you say in this book, these children are going to face the temptations, and they're really powerful temptations of the world today. So,
yes.
But But what you're doing is really increasing the probability that they'll know what they're about if you're doing these things, if you're living your faith joyfully.
Absolutely. You know, the I mentioned at the beginning of the book that your children have free will, and this book is not a guarantee that your children are going to stay Catholic if you do all these things. They have free will, and I point out, even Jesus, who did everything perfectly, lost one of his 12 apostles. Mm-hmm. And that's because Judas had free will like the rest of them. And even the rest of the apostles ended up at some point fleeing and failing, but 11 of the 12 came back. And I can say this much, that if you follow the advice I give in this book, number one, it's going to make it a lot easier for your kids to want to be Catholic. And even if they go astray, like I said, like the example I gave you of the family I told you about, they'll be able to compare their future life and all the sadness that they had with their past life and the joyful Catholic upbringing they had. And they'll say, there's no comparison. They'll have that prodigal son moment where they say, you know, how many in my father's house abound with bread while I perish with hunger? And then that'll make it so much easier for them to come back. So one way or the other, if you're doing the right things and you're living a joyful Catholic life, that's going to help them either stay Catholic or come back to the Catholic faith if the world overcomes them with the deceptions and temptations which it so powerfully presents to young people.
888-318-7884. Father Sebastian Walshe, our guest. The book is Always a Catholic. And if you have questions about helping to keep your children in the faith or questions perhaps about helping them return to the faith, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. The basic directions, I guess, that are in all of us of the moral life are do good and avoid evil. But you say, as a parent, stress do good more than avoid evil. And it's striking, because in the world, there's so much that we want to say, stay away from that. That's not for you. Yes. That's not going to give you what you think you want. But you say stress do good more than avoid evil.
Yes. And one of the reasons for that is our natural tendencies are to stress the avoid evil part. Yeah. It's so much easier to punish a child when they're doing something wrong, and it just comes to mind. Like if you see a kid doing something wrong, you immediately think punish him. But how often do you think reward him and encourage him and praise him when he's doing something good, right? Right. Just a simple example. I remember years ago I was sitting in the dining room with the family, and there was a grandfather in the room who had himself had many children and many, many grandchildren. And he was probably in his 70s at this point. And he was known as a parent for being really strict with his kids. And one of his grandkids was doing something he shouldn't be doing. And he called the little grandson over and he said, if you do this, go over and do that and behave, I'll give you a quarter. And he went away happy and went and did it. And then he turned to me and he said, it took me a long time to learn that. Just a little thing, like, you know, you can react to the same exact, you know, facts in different ways. And right. And the fact of the matter is that the moral life, the only reason why you avoid evil is so you can do good. When it all comes down to, we're about happiness, not avoiding pain. You know, the moral life can't just be about avoiding pain and suffering. It has to be affirmatively about becoming happy. And St. Thomas has this amazing treatment when he's talking about the vice of pusillanimity, small-souledness. And he asks whether or not it's worse than vainglory. Vainglory is like this desire to sort of for your own excellence. And he says, no, pusillanimity, small-souledness, where you don't do the goods you could do, that's actually much worse than vainglory, because it results in the omission of much good. And the omission of much good ends up being more harmful to the moral life than the doing of evil sometimes. And, you know, so it's a striking fact that the moral life is primarily about doing good and secondarily about avoiding evil.
Father Sebastian Walshe, our guest, 888-318-7884, our number. You are welcome to call 888-318-7884. We've got a free ebook for you. It's called Understanding the Book of Revelation. We try to have a free ebook available from time to time, and this is one lots of people have wanted help with, Understanding the Book of Revelation. So that's what's available right now. You just go to shop.catholic.com, you click on the banner for the free ebook, and you get it. That's it. Shop.catholic.com. It's free. It's an ebook, and it's called Understanding the Book of Revelation.
There's only one Catholic Answers Live. The Aquinas Writing Advantage program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
EWTN, teaching the truth.
I had called in last spring about talking to my parents and I was going to convert to the church and how to talk to them. They were not happy at all, but I was confirmed to the church at the Easter Vigil service, and we really don't talk about the topic, but our relationship is still intact, so that's a good thing. Just wanted to say thank you, and I still listen every day because I always learn something new.
EWTN, live truth, live Catholic.
It's a book much needed in our day. Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith for Life and Bring Them Back If They've Strayed. 888-318-7884 is our number. If you have questions in that vein, Father Sebastian Walshe is our guest. 888-318-7884. I sometimes feel myself, Father, now that my wife and I have raised our children, that when I see folks with young children, I want to give them a sense of urgency about sharing the faith with their kids, not a sense of easygoingness about it. And for this reason, the people who are trying to take it away are working really hard, and they will be in your home before you realize it. But the kid will see something on the internet or even on the Disney Channel, and I'm not trying to pick on Disney. I'm just saying that these messages that in various ways undermine the faith get to your children before you thought they were going to. You think you've got till 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade. You don't have that much time, and be careful now. Do you feel the same way?
Yes. Oh, yeah. And as a priest, I know that's a fact. You know, one of the things as a priest, I have a privileged viewpoint to the interior lives, the consciences of young people who come to confession and things like that. And I can tell you that most parents have no idea how early their children are exposed to bad things through the internet. They're completely clueless. And I often say, you know, you're roughly in my generation here, Cy. When you and I were kids, the internet did not exist. And so we don't think about the internet as a really, you know, we don't think about it in terms of exactly how dangerous it can be with regard to all sorts of things. And I don't mean just pornography, though that's, I think, the primary problem, but also, you know, ideas that they're ingesting through the internet, predators over the internet, bad relationships over the internet, and things like that, right? We have no idea sort of what sort of things are happening there. And I often say this next generation, the people who are basically 25 and younger, who grew up with the internet as children, are getting the short shift because of the fact that their parents didn't protect them, because their parents didn't know what to protect them from.
Right.
Their parents have the internet as full-grown adults with an already developed and formed moral life that allows them to have guards and filters to protect them against the, you know, a lot of the stuff that's coming in. But they don't realize their children don't have those guards and filters on them. And, you know, while they're over in the kitchen, their kids on the internet, unbeknownst to them, looking at something for the first time they've never seen and they shouldn't be seeing. I would estimate, for example, just to give you a, you know, this might be a surprise to many listeners, I would estimate the first time a child is exposed to pornography is about 8 years old now.
Oh, my Lord.
And most parents think that that doesn't happen till they're 15.
Yeah.
And
right.
And then you just can't be, naive anymore. You need to have the internet really locked down if you have children in your house, all the way till, you know, their minds are formed, till the early 20s. You know.
Right. And certainly, if you're an 8-year-old child, you are not. I mean, all of us are vulnerable, but that's a level of vulnerability to that kind of imagery that is really. Enormous, and a lifelong hurt could be done very quickly at that age.
Yeah, and they feel very ashamed of it, so of course they won't tell their parents about it. But then at the same time, it puts a hook in them that makes them, you know, start to want to go back to it, you know. And so it's a very deadly thing, and often the parents don't find out about it until it's years later, you know.
Yeah.
So I advise, I mean, the internet's just one thing. And I have a whole chapter on the kinds of influences that can happen in your home. But if I had to say public enemy number one for the Catholic faith of your children in your home, it's going to be the internet. And so I recommend being extremely cautious. Over, you know, from your perspective, from the way the modern world thinks, overly cautious.
Yeah.
For example, I think it's crazy to get a teenager a smartphone. If you've given your teenager a smartphone, you've essentially condemned them to a life of struggling with immense temptations throughout their whole life. And that's a sin on a part of a parent. I don't think any parent should give their children a smartphone. They're not developed, they're not ready yet, and they're going to be exposed to things that they have, in all rights, they have a right to be protected from by their parents. So.
888-318-7884. Yes, it's I really appreciate the way you said it, because I do think that that's the case, that people who for whom the internet became a thing when you were already a formed adult, and when it became a thing, it kind of gradually, slowly dawned on the world. That's not the same as an eight-year-old discovering it today, and within a matter of hours can really have their faith in their parents and in God shaken at a very, very young and vulnerable age.
Yes, that's right. And they just, they need protection, and that's your job as a parent, is to protect your children. And like I said, that may sound weird. All their friends who are not Catholics may end up having smartphones, or all their friends might have easy access to the internet, and they're going to wonder, like, why are we different and why can't we be like everyone else? But you know what? The first Christians weren't like everyone else either. And it's about time Christian Catholic parents take a stand and say, no more. I'm not going to go with what the world says. There's a reason why Jesus calls Satan the prince of the air. You know, he has this dominion over the means of communication in this world, and we have to be correspondingly careful and vigilant.
888-318-7884, the number. Always a Catholic is the book. If you have questions about bringing your kids up Catholic or keeping them Catholic as you bring them up, or helping them return to the faith after those many, you know, temptations or even abuses that you see on the internet have maybe got their hooks into them, 888-318-7884. We go first to Austin, Texas. Anne in Austin, Texas, thank you so much for your call. Go ahead with your question for our guest, Father Sebastian Walshe.
Hello. Hello, Father. Thank you for your
priesthood,
and thank you for being on the show today.
Thank you.
A question regarding a 28-year-old son. I have four children. This is the one wayward child. We're a very devout Catholic family. My husband has been called to the diaconate, grew up just trying super hard to raise all of our kids. We pray the rosary. And he was an altar boy, carried the cross, he read the Bible, he was a camp counselor at a Catholic camp. He also fell in, though, late high school years. He's a very intelligent, super high IQ kid who fell in with some very highly academic, non-faith-driven people, kids, and even teachers. And mm-hmm. then he went to college, to a public college, and fell away. Now what he says, and we have a very close relationship, we all do, but he says, why should he follow, you know, a bunch of old, you know, carpenters and fishermen in robes that really lived many, many years ago. They're not, you know, they didn't have education, weren't educated in the ways of the world. So he's just sort of fallen away from our wonderful Catholic faith, and it's hard to sort of speak on the subject anymore. And he moved out to California.
Well, there's your problem right there. That's Father and I both live in California. All right, and I just interrupt you only for this. I want to let Father respond, and we can maybe have a little conversation. Father?
Sure, absolutely. So look, it's interesting the way he puts it. St. Thomas Aquinas actually mentions, he says, why didn't Jesus call among his apostles more educated men, right? He had a few. He had St. Paul, for example, and then there was Nicodemus and so forth. He says, why did Jesus call mostly uneducated fishermen and, as he said, carpenters and whatever else? Why did he call them? And he said, in order to manifest that the power of the Christian faith was not because of human ingenuity or human wisdom or human ability, but that it had to be from God. You know, how do a bunch of carpenters and fishermen and uneducated people who'd never even been in a square of a big city, how do they convert the whole world to a new religion? And so that's something right in and of itself, that if your son's willing to admit that the foundations, the original people in our religion, were so ignorant, then that the fact that they were able to influence so greatly the history of the world in a striking way is already a sign of its divine origin. But nevertheless, St. Thomas then adds, but in order that the faith might not be impugned as being simply for the illiterate, God did, the Lord Jesus did call some who were learned in order to make a defense of the faith. And supreme among those in the recent, you know, in the last half of the church would be St. Thomas Aquinas himself. And I would recommend that your son really engage in, if he's willing to be intellectually honest, engage in the high-level theology and philosophy that the Catholic Church has to offer in the whole Catholic tradition. My sense is he probably is utterly unaware of the great contribution to science, to philosophy, to theology, to the whole development of culture and its highest expressions that Catholics and members of the Catholic Church have made. Starting, of course, like I said, the best person he can go to is St. Thomas Aquinas. And then we've got, you know, you've got more particular groups that are dedicated to a defense of the faith. You know, the first one I think of always is Catholic Answers. But there are many, many excellent resources with regard to, if you have serious, strong intellectual objections to the truth of the Catholic faith, then bring it on. We have no fear. The church has no fear. We're able to engage with even the most sophisticated, you know, science, philosophy, theology, whatever objections people want to make. The Catholic Church is open and available for business on that front too. So I offer that as a way of saying, okay, if your son's serious about that, then say, okay, why don't you engage then with people who really are knowledgeable philosophers, theologians, scientists, and see whether or not they have a reason for the hope which is within them. Okay. So that would be my first recommendation for him.
Anne, what do you think?
Yes, it sounds great. Sometimes he's resistant to that. I've worked on him a little bit on that, but I will continue to send the resources, and I'm going to send him something from St. Thomas Aquinas. And
great.
Catholic Answers is where it's at for me, so I send him stuff all the time. And he takes it, but he I'm not sure he's ready, but he...
Go ahead. Where does he live in California, Ann?
He lives in San Francisco. Oakland.
Oakland. Oh, he's up there. Okay. I thought if he's down here in Southern California, then ask him if he's willing to meet with me. I would meet with him and talk to him about that. But there are some good sound priests up there in the Oakland and also San Francisco archdiocese there that he could meet with. So
yeah, that's where he is.
If he's willing. When he's willing, you know, that would be the step to take. There's also the secondary thing, and that is ask him about like what's going on in his moral life and whether or not there aren't secondary motives that are going on there. Rarely is an intellectual abandonment of the Catholic faith purely intellectual. There's usually another component to it, and he might not be willing to talk about that, but, you know, maybe his dad should talk to him a little about those things. So, okay.
And I hope that that's all helpful to you. I just want to tell you about my day. This is not completely self-centered, but I got to do an interview this morning with a woman named Karin Oberg. And Karin Oberg is maybe the best astrochemist in the world. She's a professor at Harvard. And we talked to her about the Big Bang and her Catholic faith. And just spending, 40 minutes with somebody who operates at that high level. She's a member of the the Society of Catholic Scientists. But she's also just a world class scientist. And she spoke just about this with us a little bit. So it's going to come out on Focus a week or two, Darren, something like that. That's our podcast, Catholic Answers Focus. Maybe just have him listen to Karin Oberg, because here is a person who intellectually is second to nobody on this planet. I mean, you don't become a Harvard professor of astrochemistry because you're a dope and just a solid Catholic woman. And I say that in part because it gave me an opportunity to, plug our podcast. But maybe something like connecting with her class at the Thomistic Institute, or connecting with the Society of Catholic Scientists, it will help at least it's not just us here at Catholic Answers doing our best to share it, but you can really trust the authority of somebody like Karen Oberg. I don't, or maybe Father Spitzer's another one. I don't know if you've got any other suggestions, Father.
Well, and you mentioned the Thomistic Institute, and I think he's up in the Bay Area. So obviously the Dominicans there at St. Albert, they do a lot of wonderful work there on intellectual fronts. And so if your son is willing to engage in that conversation, then encourage him once he's willing.
Karen Oberg is the name of the person I suggested. If you just look on Focus in the next week or two, it'll be up there at CatholicAnswersFocus.com. And maybe just share that interview with them, because she has all the charm of the Catholic faith, you know, that she's a true Catholic and a tremendous scientist. And maybe that'll shake something loose. Right back with more with our guest, Father Sebastian Walshe, right after this.
This is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Thank you for listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Most of us Catholic parents agree our number one goal in life is to pass on the faith to our children. But here's the bad news. Today's world has a million ways to steal your kid's soul. Don't be afraid, says Father Sebastian Walshe. God loves your children even more than you do, and he desires their salvation more than anything. In his groundbreaking new book, Always a Catholic, Father Walshe shows you how to cooperate with God to bring about the fulfillment of his will for your kids. Always a Catholic reminds us that keeping our kids in the faith is about the way we live our Catholicism in our own lives and as a family from day to day. Order your copy of Always a Catholic by visiting shop.catholic.com today or ask for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I mean, just this weekend, given a talk with people my age, you know, we've got grown children, and you can't give a talk to a room full of people, all social distancing, by the way, all wearing masks. I just want you to know that of our age, without the question, you know, and really the thing that you can see the hurt in the eyes of moms and dads our age of. Why did they reject this? They had every reason not to, and they did. That's what Father Sebastian Walshe's book is about, is preventing that in the future and helping those of us who have suffered through that kind of mourning and loss of a child becoming disconnected from the faith. The book is called Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith for Life and Bring Them Back If They've Strayed. 888-318-7884 is our number. 888-318-7884. Father, I know that your emphasis in here is really the best thing is for them not to stray. And I think some of us almost have a romanticized idea of, oh, everyone's got to have their time away from the faith. And but that's not true, is it?
No, it's not true. And within our religion itself, we see that there's two kinds of people that God gathers to himself. There's those who never strayed, and then those who strayed and came back. And God intends both, so to speak. You know, for some people, that's the only path that they're going to grow on in God's providence, and we shouldn't give up hope. But God normally intends for us not to sin. When we come into the world, you know, his desire is that we're like Our Lady, you know, we're like, you know, the beautiful saints who never lost their baptismal innocence, like Teresa of Lisieux and so forth. Yeah. That's God's original intention and design. And in some sense, it's only a lack of gratitude that makes us, you know, move away from that original intention of God. But obviously, if your children don't stray, what's going to happen is they're going to be saved a lot of suffering, sorrow, pain, as will you.
Yeah.
And there's no sense. We already have crosses in this world. There's no sense in making your own crosses and constructing heavier crosses than the one God intends for you. But we do that. Our sin, our failure to trust in God ends up resulting in heavier crosses of our own making. Those are the ones that are really unbearable. And God doesn't want us to suffer if we don't have to.
888-318-7884, our number, 888-318-7884. So will you run us through some of what you have learned as a priest about how to avoid that? I mean, and I don't want any parent to feel like it's your fault that it happened, how to give your child, that little boy or girl, the best chance of growing into adulthood without losing their faith.
Yes. Well, when it comes down to it, there's a single principle that I outlined at the very beginning of my book. And that single principle is this: your children will remain Catholic if they think being Catholic will help them to be happy. That's a simple principle right there, right then and there. And you can do things that can assist that experience and that conviction in your children's souls, or that can get in the way and be obstacles of that. You know, to give a simple example, let's say their experience of the sacraments, right? You can do things to assist a joyful experience of the sacraments. You don't know how many people I've met as a Catholic who said, like, I had this horrible experience with whatever sacrament, confession or confirmation or whatever. And I think, gosh, it's a shame that they had negative associations with that. You know, I give examples in the book, like, let's say your child is preparing for their first confession and first communion. Well, what do? Well, you make that a special time, right? You, in the ideal world, you're able to somehow schedule just a kind of an individual first confession with a priest. You let them know in advance, I've got a kid who's going to make their first confession, and make sure that, you know, I want them to have a very positive experience of that. And then you bring them personally to the confessional, you pray with them outside, and you let them go in. When they come out, you give them a big hug and you tell them how proud you are of them. Then you go home and you have a party, you celebrate with your whole family. Make it a time of all these positive experiences and associations, right?
Yes.
And that's, you know, at the beginning, you know, it's one of the chapters of my book, little children need ice cream happiness. Meaning, like, when they're very young, they just need positive associations, positive feelings associated with the practice of their faith, right? Now, conversely, you can be an obstacle because you can have these negative associations with the practice of their faith. And I'll give a couple examples. On the one hand, you could have this situation where you've got this, you know, Catholic family that seems very ideal. They're very traditional, and everyone has their hands folded like that, and the girls have their mantillas on, and they kneel bolt upright in church and everything like that. But it's all from fear. You know, their dad or their mom is telling them, just like, you know, if you don't behave in church, you're going to go to hell. And so what happens is that primary idea of, like, really it's all about avoiding evil. They see the whole experience of the Catholic faith as avoiding punishment. And they have this very fearful experience, and they're constantly afraid of everything. And so they constantly have these negative emotions always associated with the practice of their faith. That's not helpful for them. They need to have positive experiences that involve joy, not fearful experiences and sad experiences that involve, you know, negative emotions. And another example that comes in that a lot of people don't even recognize is when you have in a marriage, almost always in every marriage, even if both spouses are Catholic and seriously Catholic, one spouse is almost always more devout than the other. It's very rare that you've got a kind of an equality with regard to the devotion of the parents. And what often happens is the more devout parent sees it as their role to protect their children from the less devout parent, from their bad influences. And so they think the natural thing they have to do is, well, I have to love God more than my spouse, and therefore I have to attack my spouse for the sake of making sure my children don't fall into his or her bad example. And what happens from the perspective of the children is, mom and dad, when they argue, it's always about the Catholic faith. And so their association of the Catholic faith is, it drives a wedge between my parents. And now what child will want to embrace a faith that drives a wedge between their parents? And so while the more devout Catholic parent thinks they're doing everything that's right to help their kid remain Catholic, what in fact they're doing is they're driving their children away from the faith because they're giving them extremely negative associations. They think being a Catholic means fighting parents, means parents who don't love one another, means parents who are distant from each other. And, you know, you have to take the approach that St. Monica took, you know, that she wasn't criticizing her husband. She wasn't attacking him in front of her son. She wasn't doing any of that. She was just saying, well, the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the believing wife. And therefore, what my faith teaches me is that my love and attention to my husband does not depend on him being a faithful Catholic, right? I'm supposed to love and be attentive to him and show him affection and kindness in every consideration because I'm a Christian, because I'm a Catholic. And it's not dependent on his success as a Catholic, and the same way for a husband towards his wife. So if the children see that the Catholic faith is a reason why the more devout parent is actually more attentive, more loving about to their spouse, to their other parent, then that's a reason the children will have positive associations. They'll think of the faith as glue that holds their parents together, not as a wedge that drives them apart.
Again, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884, the number. Father Sebastian Walshe, our guest. We're talking about keeping your kids in the faith for life. That's part of the subtitle of his new book, Always a Catholic. 888-318-7884. It's fun. When you were speaking about that, you know, I come from a family of, I have six brothers and sisters. There's seven of us, in case you had any trouble with that arithmetic. there's one of me. So I don't know why I said that. But I was just realizing that for each of our sacraments, my mother threw a party. I don't know how many parties that meant in the course of our young lives, but for every single sacrament, she threw a party.
Absolutely, right. It's exactly that kind of simple thing and that sense of being like, here, you've done something really great and it's worthy of celebration. and for, you know, young people to grow up with that sense of the joy of being a Catholic. And, you know, there's nothing like it. And I might add that not just with regard to sacraments, but with regard to the practice of the Catholic faith in general, you know, just when a parent sees their child just doing something that's matter-of-factly Catholic, to say a word of praise and to tell them how proud they are of that. And, you know, when they see their children praying, just, you know, they leave the church and their child stays back to pray for a little bit, you know, to just take them aside and a little quiet word and a hand on the shoulder and just say, I'm so proud that you're developing your own relationship with our Father in heaven, you know, and things like that. It's just a beautiful word. And then, of course, there's your own joyful example. You do those things. Your children will do what you do, right? In spite of the fact that they seem to try to do the opposite of what you do many times, eventually they're going to do what you do, right? As long as they think you love them and care about them, they're going to follow your example.
888-318-7884, the number. Your questions welcome. We got to take a quick break right now. It is spring. We have done the research here, and we found out it is spring. It took an extensive use of the supercomputers here at Catholic Answers, but we now know it's spring. So spring sale is appropriate now. You can get 10 to 25% off at shop.catholic.com. What can you get 10 to 20% off of? It's everything. Shop.catholic.com.
It's all about the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Want the latest pro-life news? Want it delivered? Sign up. It's free. EWTN Pro-Life Weekly, your source for everything happening now in the fight to protect the sanctity of human life. New episodes delivered every week to your inbox. So if you really want to know,
sign up today.
Go to ewtn.com/pro-life today.
Do you want to end abortion, halt the attack on traditional marriage, and ensure religious freedom for ourselves and for our grandchildren? To do this, we must convert the culture. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a grassroots initiative that recognizes this need and takes it to the streets. If you're interested in peacefully sharing the gospel in your area, visit streetevangelization.com to learn more.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Thanks so much for being with us. I'm Cy Kellett, your host. Tomorrow we're going to do 2 hours of open forum. I think Jimmy here both hours tomorrow? Do you remember? You'll tell me in a minute, and I'll let you know. The number now, 888-318-7884, our good friend Father Sebastian Walshe of the Norbertine community here in Southern California, St. Michael's Abbey up in Orange County, is our guest. He's got a brand new book for us here at Catholic Answers called Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith and Bring Them Back If They Have Strayed. You are welcome to call with your questions, 888-318-7884. And I see what it is. I see this is, it's one of those Monday things. Everybody waited until the last, look, all the lines lit up now. Every single line lit up, Father. They all waited. Here's the problem. I'm going to tell you all the problem with your parenting right now before I even talk to you. It's procrastination. I don't know what other problems you have, but procrastination.
I know as a priest that if you have a 2 hours set up for confession, then 90% of the people will come in the last 10 minutes. I can tell you that.
It's because we know you'll be easier on us. We've tired you out by then. you'll be easier on us at the end. I'm not even going to give out the number anymore. There's so many people who want to get on with you. But this, you know, you said people have bad experience with the sacraments, but this is also a thing that preparing your children for the sacraments at home is an important part of your Catholic parenting. If you don't know how to do it, there's a lot of resources, but do prepare your children for the sacraments.
Yes. Remember, the primary duty of the education of the children is not the local parish, not the Catholic school. It's you, the Catholic parent. And even if you're not Catholic, you know, maybe you're a non-Catholic, you know, your spouse is Catholic and you're not, and nevertheless your children being raised Catholic, you still have a role to play in your children's education and help them understand that. Maybe you can understand that your spouse's Catholic faith better and so forth. But the primary role of educating the children falls to the parents, and that involves also sacramental preparation, you know, a catechesis and things like that. That should first start in the home, and then from there, you're assisted by your local parish. You're assisted by the Catholic schools.
I have to say, Father, if you're lucky, you're assisted. Sometimes, and you have a chapter on that in here too. But
That's right.
You have to get the book to read that chapter. I'm not going to try to sum that. But the truth is, I mean, many of our institutions are in trouble. And so as a parent, you don't always get the support of the institutions of the church in the way that you did before, and maybe will again before too long. Steubenville, Ohio, Tabitha up next. Tabitha, thank you so much for your call. Go ahead with your question for Father.
Yes, so I had a question. I converted later in life, and I had my daughter outside of marriage. And so whenever I converted to Catholicism, she was about 4. And since then, you know, I've gotten married and we try really hard to live out the faith. But she has turned 9 this year, and she has just reached a point where she just doesn't know what she believes. And I feel like it's very early for her to even have some of the questions that she has.
Okay.
I'm just not very sure how to address them, because I feel like she doesn't believe me.
Yes. Okay. Well, good. I have a little chapter in there saying, don't panic if your children question their faith. There's got to be a point when they make the faith their own, and that's a natural thing. Now, I agree with you that 9 is kind of young. And what that tells me, it tells me 2 things. The first thing it tells me is she's probably getting a lot of exposure to anti-Catholic or contrary to Catholic teaching information on the internet and through school. So how much access does she have to the internet, and how often, and is she in some kind of, what's her schooling environment or educational environment like?
So she goes to a Catholic private school here, and we don't want, like, I tend to limit how much she actually uses the internet. I really am unaware if she's using the internet and I don't know about it. But I mean, maybe like 30 minutes a day. She might use the TV for 30 minutes a day. She doesn't have a smartphone. You know, like, I only have one computer in my house, and it's in my dining room. And
I would go and I would make sure, you know, exactly go through the history and figure out exactly, you know, what your child has been looking at the internet. I would be very careful about that. And I would, just a matter of course, I wouldn't have her on the internet without you being physically present. Okay, that's the first thing, is just being able to just sort of watch. For a 9-year-old especially, I can't tell you, again, how often I've seen children at that young age deeply harmed through the internet when parents have no clue about what they're seeing and what they're actually getting on the internet. So that's one thing. The other thing is, I have a chapter in my book about Catholic schools, and just because your child's going to a private Catholic school does not mean they're getting a Catholic education. In fact, very often they're getting the opposite. And I would look at certain questions, like, for example, are the faculty members there at that school, are they practicing Catholic? Are they someone who really supports the teaching of the church? Do they consider themselves progressive and trying to push the envelope and getting the church to change her teachings on things? Like, you know, we have to really be deeply involved. Like, who is teaching her children? Who's giving her these ideas? Because I guarantee you, a 9-year-old who's in a healthy, happy Catholic family environment is not getting these ideas from herself. She's getting them from someone and somewhere. And you need to find out where that's coming from. Okay, that'd be the first thing. The second thing I would do is I would just ask, so what's her relationship with her dad? I mean, what are the family relationships there? Does she feel loved by both her mom and her dad? And does she feel like she belongs and she's in a situation where she's content with her family relationships?
Tabitha?
Right. She doesn't know her dad. So yeah. It's something that I've addressed this last year. I've seen some connection to it, or somehow this man that she doesn't feel has acknowledged her has somehow made her question her worth. I've attempted to kind of draw a connection. I've made him very aware that's something that's happening, so that he can, you know, reach out to her. So,
and the man that you're married to now, is he taking the role of a loving father, a loving parent, and caring for her? And is there a lot of good, close affection there, or what's going on with regard to that?
Yes. So, like, for us to be a blended family, it's a very natural flowing. I mean, we kind of he had a son, and I have her, and you know, we just kind of took on the role as mom and dad. We don't do stepmom, stepdad. You know, we kind of just, everybody, it kind of try to be as close to a traditional family as we can be. I kind of worry about the amount of hypocrisy that our children see in us promoting a traditional family when we're not one.
Mm-hmm. Well, no, there's no need in saying that there's some hypocrisy in promoting a traditional family. What you're doing is, it's precisely because you think a traditional family is the best setting for raising children that you want to make your family as close to a traditional family as possible, right? So that's not hypocrisy. It's actually saying, well, this is, while we can't have this in a perfect way, we want to get as close as possible to that. And so absolutely have no fear in saying, look, we didn't do everything the right way, but we, given what we did, we're going to try and make it as good as possible. And this is how we do it. You know, and so have no fear about that. But I suspect with 9 years old, if there's questions about the faith, that's a double cause. One is, you already mentioned, she's starting to question her self-worth, and that's kind of a moral root of what's going on. And then the other thing is, she's getting access to objections and problems from some source that you need to find out, and you need to be able to protect her from those things when she's too young to be wrestling with a lot of those objections and problems. So that's what I would say.
But so many kids who are, just objectively, you'd say that is too young for that to be occurring to them or for them to be struggling with that. So many are. Tabitha, God bless you. You sound like such a loving and good mom. If you want to hang on the line, I'd love to send you both of Father Sebastian Walshe's books for us here at Catholic Answers. Always a Catholic, the book we're talking about today, and his other book, Secrets from Heaven, Hidden Treasures of Faith in the Parables and Conversations of Jesus. Thanks, Tabitha. I'm going to try to get another, at least one more caller on here with Father before we go. And so I'm going to go to Evangeline in Fremont, Nebraska, listening on Facebook Live. Evangeline, you there with us?
Yes, I am.
All
right. Thank you. Thank you for taking my call.
Happy to.
So I am a single mom. I'm a single parent. Mm-hmm. I was married. I'm still married. But my husband is struggling with health issues, and he thought it would be safe to be away for the moment, but it's been 3 years now. So I feel like I'm on my own, and I'm in charge of my child, including the faith. I am a very faithful Catholic, and I want to raise my child the same way. I do not find guidelines or instructions or helpful advice for families like me. So I was wondering if Father has any tips or sections in his book or any resources I can go to for someone like me. I do not plan to be married. Again, I don't plan to divorce. I am hoping for a miracle. But in the meantime, I'm afraid what I should do.
Well, thank you, Evangeline. Father?
I did. I specifically wrote into the book that particular advice for people that are from non-traditional family situations, for example, where either a spouse has died or where the family's been wounded by divorce, or in your case, just physical separation. I don't know. I don't understand exactly all the circumstances of your husband's health situation. I mean, does he even have contact with his child kind of regularly by phone or some sort of that kind of regular contact? Or is he just completely not in contact with the children, with his child?
I try to reach out. He responds. He calls. If I call, he doesn't initiate.
Okay.
But right. I try my best. It's hard, but I do because I know it's important for my child. So I do that.
Okay.
I reach out.
Okay.
I share pictures, have pictures in the home. We draw pictures every time. We have to include that because there can't be a baby without mom and dad, things like that. So, but he doesn't show up physically.
Okay, I understand. Okay, so and in a case like that, look, the first thing and the most important thing is for your child, for the good of your child, is to help your child to love your father with his problems. And without assigning moral blame there, I don't know exactly what's happening with him, but it's whatever it is, it doesn't sound like how a father should be to his child, even regardless of whatever health problems he's having, unless maybe they're mental health problems. The fact of the matter is you need to encourage your child to love their father and to pray for their father. And on your part, you make sure that you stay away or steer away from unnecessary criticism of your child's father. And your child will see the defects and they'll say, like, it's not how it should be. And you can admit that and you say, no, this isn't how it should be. Your dad should be more involved in your life, but he's not. But he gave you life, and I'm very grateful to your dad for giving you life. And I want to do the best I can to help you love your father. And maybe that love and that prayer will be something that will help him to grow so he can become the father that God wants him to be. So that would be my first piece of advice. Help your child to love her dad or his dad with his problems.
Evangeline, if you hang on the line, we'll send you to Father Walshe's two books as well. But as you can hear the music, we have to go. God bless you. Thank you for that call. Sorry, that's all we were able to get to. Father, may we have your blessing before we go.
Of course. Per intercessione Beata Maria Virginis et Omnum Sanctorum, benedictus Dei Omnipotentis Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti, descendat super vos, et mania semper.
Amen. Father Sebastian Walshe has been our guest. You can get the book over at shop.catholic.com. It's called Always a Catholic, How to Keep Your Kids in the Faith for Life and Bring Them Back if they've strayed. Father Sebastian Walshe, thank you very, very much.
You're welcome. Bye-bye.
Bye. Tomorrow, 2 hours with who? Jimmy Akin. Open forum. We'll see you then, God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.